Welcome to the Discount Property Investor Podcast, where we show you how to buy real estate at a discount so you can create wealth over time and income today. Our mission is to share what we have learned from the experience of others and help you make more money investing like a pro. We want to teach you how to create wealth by investing in real estate, the Discount Property Investor way. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening to the Discount Property Investor Podcast. If you enjoyed this episode, please like, share, and subscribe to help us reach a wider audience. We would also appreciate it if you left us a review on iTunes or Stitcher. Thanks in advance for your support. And remember, you make your money when you buy and get paid when you sell. Now, let's go build some wealth.
All right, guys, thanks for joining. Welcome back. This is the Discount Property Investor Podcast. We are welcome today with a special guest, a friend and a St. Louis native, Jeff Coffman. And, of course, your co-host, Mr. Mike Slane, myself, David Dodge. We want to remind you guys, as always, check out thefreewholesalecourse.com. The free wholesale course is jam-packed with tons of information on how to get started wholesaling. And as well, if you are a St. Louis native like Mr. Jeff here, we recommend and suggest checking out the discountpropertyinvestor.com to find local wholesale deals here in the St. Louis market. So today we have Jeff Coffman with us. He is a special guest. He is, I would consider to be the subject to expert.
That was last week.
The subject to expert here in town.
Spoken like a true real estate investor.
Today we're wearing this
hat, right? Exactly. So I met Jeff, I think it was online several months ago, and we had gotten together for a couple different events and had talked subject to. And he knew the business so well that when I got the leads that would come across the desk, I would either call him for advice or just send him the leads, because he was that much better at it, had more experience doing it, and had done a couple dozen of these to date. So that's kind of how I met Jeff, and I'm thrilled to have him in here today, and hopefully the listeners and the viewers can learn something about the subject to investing game.
Yeah, absolutely. So Jeff, would you mind giving us just like a brief description? I mean, what is subject to? I mean, what does that even mean?
For, I don't know, your audience is a, I know you target generally a newer audience. So for, sure, for the newer folks, subject to financing is when you're going to go out and buy a property that no matter what amount of equity is in it, you are going to purchase that property, but the financing is going to stay where it's at. The financing from the seller is going to stay in place, and you are going to, I hate to say assume, because you're not going to assume the loan. You are going to assume the debt, but you are not going to sign for the debt.
So you are going to, okay.
Yeah,
there's a
big difference between,
so
actually assuming
the debt, meaning that you're going to kind of like take over responsibility.
It's a bad way to put it.
It really is, it's true.
Right.
It's true. Right. So the loan stays in the name of the seller, but you're not just like starting this to mail a check. Like, there's actually a closing process and legal documentation. So let's walk through a scenario if you don't mind.
Sure.
So we actually had a scenario just the other day where we had a lady that said, listen, I'm about to file bankruptcy. It wasn't a good enough deal for us to just cash her out at what she owed for a wholesale. But I'm still considering, I'm still working the deal. But she was to the point where she was so motivated that she said, listen, if you can just help me, start making these payments, then we'll do whatever we need to do. So it actually may be a deal that we just passed to Jeff after all.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, it was a subject to deal. So she had a lot of questions that I unfortunately wasn't able to answer for her. But I explained it to her, and Mike was in the room with me, and I said, listen, we're going to take over the payments, and, our exit would be to, get a tenant buyer in there, because there really wasn't much value add for us to do anything else. The house didn't need much. We were going to get a tenant buyer in there and then, hope that tenant buyer was able to cash her out in, 2, 3, 4 years, something along those lines. But there was no guarantees.
Right.
And she had a lot of questions for me that, you know, again, I wasn't able to answer, you know, so.
So she, did she, but she, so there's no equity in the deal, obviously.
Well, there was a little bit. So in this particular deal, she owed 89.7, like call it 90,000. The home was listed for 130,
yeah, you know, she, ish. I mean, she had a contract accepted, my understanding was right around there, like 130.
Right.
Was what I thought she'd said.
Right.
But there were some issues with the property, and it was a first-time buyer, so they backed out. So again, I think the Airbnb on the property is probably 120. Mm-hmm. I mean, so the property is probably worth 120, 130, somewhere right in that range.
And everything was tip-top minus the plumbing that was under the ground.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, it didn't need paint. It didn't need a new roof. It didn't need windows. It was move-in ready. And it was, quite honestly, one of the cleanest houses I've ever been in.
It was a two-bedroom, one-bath, full basement.
I mean, it was cleaner than my house, and I'm a neat freak.
Was she okay with the long-term situation? Was she okay with 1 or 2 or 3 year?
So we're still talking with her and negotiating with her, and it seems to me like she would be interested in that. She just needed more information about how the whole process goes, you know, because there actually is a closing that takes place.
Sure.
And then there's a way to obviously structure that strategically.
Well, and what we say, I mean, Dave said it, is we're not the experts on subject two.
Right.
So I guess we didn't really position it that well because we're not as familiar with it.
Sure.
So, I mean, how would you talk to a seller in this situation? I mean, how would you present
that? So just to give you all the figures, she owed 90. The house was probably worth between 120 and 125, and there was essentially about $10,000 worth of plumbing that needed to be done. Now, again, this wasn't like you drive up and you're like, oh, this needs plumbing. It was all hidden. It's all underground. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So, but that was,
she had the bid. There was actually tape from the contractors where they
on
marked
the concrete. Right. Yeah. So she was super nice because she was full disclosure with us. Yeah. She said, hey, there's a plumbing issue here. It was a sewer lateral line and whatnot.
She felt her alternative was foreclosure or bankruptcy.
So she could no longer afford the house.
Because it was actually listed currently, but she was canceling the listing.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously that's how you're going to make your, that's how you're going to plead your case to your client is
right.
Her ultimate motivation. Mm-hmm. I mean, she seems like, just from what you're explaining, she seems like the perfect candidate
right.
for.
They have to be motivated, right?
For a subject to deal.
Right.
I mean, she's prime. I guess the way that I would handle that is I don't ever, point number one, I never ever mention the word subject to
really?
A client. Ever.
Very interesting.
I never do.
Good to know.
Lesson
again,
number one.
We are not
yourself.
Experts.
I've done it before.
Okay.
Twice.
Right.
And it's killed me both times.
No,
I know they were good. I knew they were good deals.
Right. So instead of that, how do you pitch?
Yeah. So I mean, talk to us.
I
like
will,
you were her or something.
It kind of put me on the spot, but I will generally, I'll put it in a way that makes them feel more comfortable, and it's sort of like asking them what they owe on their mortgage. Like, that's not a comfortable question for a lot of people.
Right, right.
But kind of the way I put it is, you know, this is probably not going to be not a lot of teeth in this, or not a lot of room in this deal.
Right.
So, I mean, either we're probably going to have to pass on it, but I do have some creative solutions. If you want to hear about it,
right?
Would you like to hear about it?
Absolutely. So if that's their
right.
response,
right?
Okay.
Right. They say yes. I say, well, one option that's open to us is you can do a short sale.
Mm-hmm.
I go through all the other options before I get to
smart. Make your option look
what
the best.
Is the right? What is the mm-hmm. ultimate goal?
You can
the
file
last
bankruptcy.
One you hear, the last one you hear is usually the best.
The best
last one.
One
you're going to remember, and it's the best option.
Right.
It's old sales.
Right.
Thing. So I will just say, you know, go through the short sale, go through the foreclosure.
Sure.
Say you can put a couple dollars in it, sell it on the market, put it on the market, and then I'll just say, or we have a program where we can come in. Now, it's different. It's a long term deal.
Right.
Which I love long term deals, but mm-hmm. If it's a short term deal, what I'll say is, not a lot in it. We'll probably need to get somebody in here to get this mortgage whittled down for us a little bit. Get a tenant in here
right.
to pay some of this off. I said, but it will require the loan to stay in place.
Right.
We'll get on title. We will immediately start taking over payments. And we generally won't drag it out any longer than 24 months. And that's how we handle it.
That's the pitch. For the most part.
Yeah, I guess. It just depends on the situation,
right,
too. Because I'll actually close on a probate deal tomorrow.
No shit.
Totally different situation where this was just an inherited property. Got beneficiary deeds involved, and I didn't have to do any of that. It was just basically just, we don't want to pay for this. What can you do? Here's $1,000.
Was it skinny, or did they just not?
No, it's a pretty good deal.
Awesome.
Pretty good deal.
Cool.
Those are exciting. Yeah.
Those are exciting. Not absolutely.
I was going to lease that one out, not to get off topic here, but I ended up getting a cash offer for it.
So, cool.
So I took that instead. But I guess really it just all depends on the situation, but if you want to get into the process of, you know, how this actually goes down once you have someone that needs this explained to them.
Right.
And you know.
Right.
So what I would do next is just tell them, like, you know, they start asking about it. I would say, you know, this is a normal sale. There's nothing abnormal about this sale. The only thing that's different is that this mortgage is going to stay in place. We're going to pay it. We're on the hook for it. We're on title. You have no other association to this property other than that lien. And we close on it at a closing company. We just like a normal closing. We
right.
Sit
it's
at
a great
table,
way to describe
we sit
it.
Sit at a beautiful table like this one.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
And we close on it.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So if they say, I love the way that you worded it, because you kind of killed a lot of the objections before they even had them,
mm-hmm.
which is super, super smart to do that. So whenever they say, okay, that sounds great. However, what do you mean it stays in my name? Am I responsible for it? So I would imagine sometimes, maybe not every time, but those questions may arise.
Right. So handling
almost
objections.
Every time they arise.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
An objection would be, is just to be very transparent with them.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it's going to stay in your name. Yes, it's on your credit.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just go into my track record,
right?
Which is, you know, I closed 9 of these deals last year. I'm on my 4th one this year.
It's awesome.
So, and I will get into payments
mm-hmm.
sooner than later. Mm-hmm. But I say I'm responsible for these payments, and I just kind of pound that in.
Right, you know, right,
make,
right.
Make sure that that's known that.
It's not their problem anymore.
I don't miss payments. Worst comes to worst. If they ask what the worst case scenario is, I deed the property back to you. That's the absolute worst thing that can happen.
Right.
Otherwise, our company's on the hook for it.
Right. And you got a great track record, which is
right.
super helpful too.
Which I do want to. Today I want to come clean on one thing.
Okay.
Let's hear it. Let's hear it.
I have missed one payment. And for all the listeners out there,
right.
never, ever, ever miss a payment.
Just a single one.
It is the single payment. It's still rearing its ugly head.
Uh-oh.
And what it was I had it's a property. I actually still have the property. And I thought I had it sold. And it was coming into that grace period when that payment was due. So I was like, well, we'll just get this sold. We won't have to make another payment. Well, it got away from me. And I ended up missing that payment.
Mm-hmm.
And to this day, I have bad relations with that seller.
But you still have the property in your name.
I do. It's deeded in my
name. So worst case scenario, like you said, you could always deed it back to them, but I'm sure you put the fire out.
I did.
So
I make that payment on the 15th every month now.
Right, right.
The previous month, the month.
Oh, wow. So you're a super ahead.
I don't mess around with it anymore.
Super ahead. That's good.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk real quick, though, about seller relations because, I mean, my understanding, and again, no experience with it, but you do have a bit of a longer relationship with the seller mm-hmm. at this point, right? Because the mortgage is in their name, so they're getting the mortgage statements, and, I mean, you've got to get those from the sellers. Is that correct, or how's that work?
The way that I work it, excuse me, the way that I will do it is once I have it under contract, we agreed on closing date.
Mm-hmm.
I have two options. I can either close it myself, or I can close it with a title company.
What do you prefer?
I prefer to close it myself, mm-hmm. just because I can go out and do a title search if I know that the title's clean. Like, I'll go out and I'll hire a title company, And for $150, I get a full title search. Don't get a, you know, don't get a preliminary or anything like that. Pay for the full title search. Get it back. Have them sit down and read it to you, how mm-hmm. they would if just as if you were going to close.
Sure.
Once I'm comfortable with knowing that there are no outstanding liens on it other than the mortgage,
mm-hmm.
I feel comfortable having them just quit claim that property to me.
Okay.
And that's what I usually do.
Okay. And you may or may not give them anything. You may give them nothing. You may give them $1,000, or usually it's a small amount of money.
Try and make it win-win.
Right.
I think the very first deal that I ever did, I literally just, I was in it for $10,000. So, which we can get into that in a little
that's
bit.
That's what you put into, that's what you put down?
That's what I actually brought her mortgage current.
Oh, wow. Oh, okay.
And in exchange for that, I got the house.
Right.
And she walked away with nothing on that one. Other
so
than
talk about a real win-win. Hopefully you made money on the deal. I'd imagine you did.
That was my very first deal.
But you saved her from foreclosure.
Well, yeah. He's talking about it like it wasn't his best deal either.
Right.
So to me, I mean, it sounds like a win-win.
Sounds like a great deal. No. Hell yeah.
And it's sounding like he's feeling too generous on that.
Right.
No, I didn't. It was the first deal. I had really no idea. And this is where I kind of fell into subject two. I really didn't have it planned out.
Mm-hmm.
And I decided, you know, I'm going to catch her, bring her current, which a lot, you know, I'm a little smarter than that now. I don't think that I would use my own cash to do that, no.
Mm-hmm.
I did do it then. So it put me at a little bit of a risk. I was in for $10,000. I walked away at the closing table with a $41,000 check, so minus the $10,000 that I was in.
That's a huge deal, man. $30,000 profit?
Yeah, that was my first one, and I thought, well, let's find a little better way to
let's
do
these
things.
Let's find some more of those. Hell yeah, that's awesome.
But yeah, so that's how that first one went down.
Go ahead, please.
As far as closings go, there are a handful of title companies in the city, and I'm sure there are across the country. And, you know, there's a lot of, like, I know in Ohio you have to use a closing attorney, but plenty of title companies that will work with you on this stuff. So you can close it. You can get a warranty deed issued, or you know you can issue one to your buyer, whether it's retail, you know, anybody, and they will just exclude that mortgage out of that title policy, out of that insurance policy.
Out of that policy.
Right.
Okay. So I have so many questions.
Yeah. Shoot.
Are you guys ready for the fire round?
Go for it.
Okay. So I have done one subject two deal, and I probably had made every mistake that you can make. But I wanted to do one, and I wanted to kind of learn the process. And I really didn't learn the process very well, but I did do one of the deals. And the way that I did it was we did close on it with a local company. The mortgage stayed in the seller's name, but I didn't have any access to the mortgage because I wasn't fully intending on paying it off in about 8 months to a year, which I did.
Mm-hmm.
It was a very small deal. But for the first 5, 6, 7 months that I owned it, I literally had her most recent statement that I was photocopying.
You were just making a payment.
And just making a payment on behalf of her for the most part.
Right.
Now, we did go to the title company prior, and it had moved over from her name into my company's name.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess I got lucky because they didn't call the loan due or nothing had happened. But I would imagine that there are strategies to where, A, they can't go pull a second mortgage or a third mortgage or whatever you'd call it, a line of credit on their home. There was probably a way to prevent them from doing that. And B, have some
there
sort of...
There was probably, you're saying that...
No, I'm saying there probably is that I didn't know about
it. If you're on title, then...
Then they couldn't do that. Okay, so that would be a way to prevent it.
Right.
But I didn't have access to the mortgage, though. Mm-hmm. So I would imagine that there are strategies in which, or things that you can do to where you kind of have more transparency on their loan, because essentially property becomes yours, you know, via the deed.
I think that was,
but there's a lien
too.
Sure. Like, how do you know about the loan stuff?
My process is first I'll have them sign a release. What do they call that? The mortgage information, like the
so it puts you as
release of information.
So,
yeah.
So that way you can contact Chase or Bank of America,
right.
Whoever, and say I need more information on
right.
this loan.
Right.
They'll look up and they'll see your name.
I do that
and
immediately.
Give it
that's
to you.
That's the first thing. I don't even get it under contract. I mean,
you gotta get that.
I
want
to know before I get into that deal
if they're late, if they're current,
right.
what the numbers are,
so
interest
that's
rate.
What I do.
Everything.
I fax it to them. They fax me back a payoff That way I know.
Got it.
Once I do have it under contract, I call it my honeymoon period, mm-hmm. where you know they're signing everything. They're just going crazy. So
they're happy about it.
They are. They right. generally, yeah.
Right.
I mean, I tell them about this way before I actually do it. But what I'll do is I'll have them sign a limited power of attorney.
Okay.
And I will file it with that mortgage company. Mm-hmm. And that is for the life of the loan.
It's for the life of the loan. So right. limited power of attorney meaning that it's limited to just that.
To that mortgage.
Okay.
It's limited to just that mortgage, mm-hmm. and you can call them anytime as long, and you know, on that power of attorney, it has the seller's social security number, it has you know all of their information you're going to need that they're going to ask you when you call in,
right,
to get this information,
right.
And I've not had a problem with it. The other thing is I require them to give me any online, if they bank online with a mortgage company, I have a little form. I have them give me all their login information, all that. This would have solved your problem.
Right.
I log in there. I change the mailing address for the statements. I change any contact. I also send the mortgage company a no contact form, so they are no longer calling the seller.
Okay.
But I will change all of that mortgage information to my company.
To your company.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Any correspondence that happens now happens with me.
Awesome.
They're still free to call in if they choose.
Right.
And hopefully it's not to rip your limited power of attorney.
And that may be one of the ways to handle an objection right there is say, listen, if you want to log into your own to the bank statements, mm-hmm. or online banking at any time to see that the payments are being made, feel free.
Sure. I just make it a requirement.
Right.
I mean, I don't just flat out don't give them the option. If I can't,
right.
I mean, you want me to make that payment.
Right.
You don't.
So I need to. You need to make it easy for me to make
right.
the payment.
You definitely
Got
want
it.
Me to make
okay.
that payment.
Hey, so. That's really good information. So by having the deed transfer from their name to yours, they can no longer go get a second mortgage on that property.
Cannot. However, you can. This property is now an asset to you.
Cool.
You're on title.
Did you
a lot of
that?
People talk
That's
about
cool.
a lot of people talk
that.
About lease options. Mm-hmm. The lease options are great. I use them. I will continue to use them.
Mm-hmm.
The reason that I like subject to is because you can actually go pull money out of that property as an asset if you choose.
Sweet.
It's a little more difficult just because they're dealing with a first that's
it's just a little bit more complicated.
Name. Yeah.
Right.
But you
right.
can do it. It's an asset. You can list it in your listed as an asset on anything that you need to.
Right. So what would be this is kind of a little different type of question, but what would be the pros and the cons of choosing one closing method over another? So you said you can do the self-close where you can literally meet them at Starbucks and have them sign over the quit claim amongst
times.
The other documents,
mm-hmm.
versus going to the title company. So what would be like, you know, the advantages of one or the other?
Two words, transfer tax.
Transfer tax.
Quit
okay.
claim, all you're doing with a quit claim, and you can have an attorney draw that up. I draw up all my own.
Sure.
And there's different municipalities have different ways they want them. I've had them kick back 100 times.
But hopefully they just say, hey, do this differently or kind of.
Well, if you're smart, you'll go on and you'll look at the prerequisites first.
Right.
I would just send the same quit claim to all these different.
Right.
And they just, you know, they would kick it back. And every
right.
time they kick it back, they charge you another fee or a penalty.
Don't you need a notary on it though too?
You do.
Well, yeah. So you've got. I mean, it can't be Starbucks necessarily unless you.
I close it at UPS stores.
Well, there you go.
And,
there you go.
That's where all of my final paperwork is signed.
Awesome.
Nice.
Good tip. Didn't know you could do that.
I did not know that either.
Yeah.
Yeah. Interesting.
But so transfer tax is the main reason.
Okay. So through a title company, you would have it, I would imagine.
If you're going to go the general warranty deed mm-hmm. route. You're probably going to have a transfer tax.
Okay.
You do have to fill out something called a.
What's transfer tax? I mean, I've done hundreds of deals. I have no idea.
It's just one of the fees at a mortgage company when you transfer title from one person to another. You pay. It's not a tax necessarily. It's a. I think they call it. I don't know if they call it a fee. It's just a transfer fee that whatever municipality you're in charges you at closing for.
Wasn't
for moving it from one person to another.
Crazy.
So you have the transfer tax for the most part, regardless of what it's called in the paperwork on the HUDs.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you do it through a title company, they're going to handle all the recordings. So you have to then handle that on your own if you don't do it through the title company, right?
Yep.
Which is easy. Just go up to the city's office and pay them to record the docs, right?
I actually signed up with EPN.
So you just online. Do it online?
Do it in my basement.
No way.
Yep. Do it online.
How cool is that?
Yeah, that's nice.
That's super cool.
They have a little tool where you line up the margins and all this stuff.
Right.
Yeah, just do it right in my basement.
Stick it right in there. Yeah. Interesting.
How much does that cost? That's a couple $100 a year, isn't it? Something like that?
No, it's free. The filings are slightly more, but it beats having to go down and parking and all that crap.
But still, you're not spending
more than $40 or $50, right?
$35, I think.
Yeah, that's
$10 more than what we're usually paying. Yeah, so it's pretty cheap.
You know, it's probably about the same as getting it done through the title company. I'm sure they mark it up a couple bucks too.
Right. Now, what about the dreaded due on sale clause?
Right.
I'm sure that all the listeners are wondering. I know I'm wondering. I've heard about this scary due on sale clause, and I didn't have to worry about it with my subject to deal. I shouldn't say I didn't have to worry about it. I wasn't affected by it. Mm-hmm. And then I've also heard other people that do a lot of subject to deals, they will they'll create an entity with like the name of the person or the address or
something real complicated.
And shady is the wrong word, you know, because it's a legit entity, but it's almost kind of like smoke and mirrors.
Yeah, they're trying to deceive the mortgage company basically
from thinking that it transferred out of their name. So again, I don't really, it doesn't matter at this point, but I was just curious, like, do you have a workaround with that, or what's the trick?
As far as due on sale goes, I couldn't tell you because it's...
Never happened.
I don't even know anybody that's ever happened to.
Me neither.
What about sellers?
Heard about it, though.
What about the sellers? You know? I mean, when they say something like that, well, what about... Or do they never bring it up?
I tell them the same thing. I wouldn't know.
I wouldn't
well
know.
Well played, sir.
All right. And if that happens, then we'll deal with it, right? But at this point, I've done a bunch of these, and...
It just doesn't happen.
If
the bank's getting their money, they don't care.
That's kind of the way I see it.
Yeah, I mean, it just goes back to make the payment. Just no matter what, just make the payment.
Right.
I mean, don't be stupid like I was and miss a payment.
Right.
Make the payment. You won't have
well, it choice. Sounds like you learned a valuable lesson there, though, you know?
Immeasurable. I mean, it's just,
Right.
So there is one other thing, and I don't even know the right question to ask. So I apologize because I'm ignorant. And
sounds like all my questions.
You might know, you might not know. So there's also the seller, another potential objection would be, well, what if I want to get a mortgage again in a couple years?
Good question.
And my understanding is there's something surrounding Dodd-Frank or one of those laws that came out that said if someone is still on a mortgage after 2 years, if the mortgage is being paid, it doesn't actually affect their lending or their credit worthiness or something like that. Again, I'm pretty ignorant, just trying to throw that out.
No, I think you're right on. It's generally like a, what they'll do is they'll consider it would be just like you moving out of your house and you renting out your house and you're going out to buy a new one.
Mm-hmm.
Your old one is considered an investment property. It's considered a rental. As long as you can go out and get another mortgage, now you've got an investment property, which if you own it for longer than a year, obviously, you know, you're getting long-term capital gains on it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's no different than that. It's absolutely, they can go out, if they've got the credit score, they can go out and get a loan.
So they're not showing income necessarily from it, but they're not.
No, they can show income. And yes, after, I can't remember the exact rule, but if it's, I want to say it's a year.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say that they're going to move to another state, and that'll be one thing that I have told somebody before. You know, why would you want to get involved? You're getting out of a house now. Why are you gonna?
It's part of your bitch.
Why don't you just go see what's out there? You know, not pushy about it, but
yeah. Why would you want to manage a property that's hundreds of miles away?
And so, but yeah, that is definitely a thing. And I think, not a lawyer, so I don't know the exact rules and regulations on it. But I want to say it's after a year. And you can actually use the income off of that. So,
well, if you're an owner and you're renting it, you can.
Oh yeah, yeah.
But I'm saying if it's a subject to seller, they wouldn't necessarily have income to claim.
That's true.
They would just have.
Yeah, I would check with your. I would check with your.
Yeah. So again, consult
check
a local
with a mortgage
attorney,
broker. Right. Mortgage broker.
But I mean, if they could show, which they would easily be able to do by logging into their online banking,
the payments are being made,
even if they're not making those payments, it shouldn't matter.
I think at that point it would come down to debt to income. And,
debt to income, you know, right. So I guess the takeaway is that it's probably case by case, but it doesn't necessarily mean that that seller won't be able to get another mortgage. It's probably going to complicate it and make it a little bit more difficult for them, of course, but I would think that they could still get another mortgage.
I would just say, you know, it might not be worth your time.
Right.
You know.
Right.
I can't help you. I'm sorry. You know,
right.
I mean, if you're not willing to do it, I just can't help you.
Right.
That has happened.
Sure. Let's talk about exit strategies. So you've done a bunch of these.
Let me interrupt you for just
please,
one second.
Please.
You were talking about entities.
Entities, yes, yes.
So you can buy a property like this in any way you want. You buy it personally.
Okay.
A lot of people like to put them in trusts.
Okay.
I like to put them in an LLC. That's my
preference.
Yeah, and we talked about this before.
Right.
I like an LLC because once I go get my insurance in that LLC on that property, and I will name...
Insurance was a question I had, too.
Mm-hmm. I will name that property eerily similar
the address,
to either the
right?
address, which is what I just did on this one,
right.
or I'll
There's
name,
nothing wrong with that.
Okay, so that is a good... I mean, that is a smart thing to do, then,
right?
So
I have one for mine.
You know, I don't know. I've never tested it, so I've never been called doing sale or anything. So,
whoever you have learned from or questioned, it was just something you picked up along the way,
right,
and that's
right.
the way that you're doing.
I have two properties that I didn't even buy subject to that are the property address LLC.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's not like
a lot of guys.
It's not an odd thing to do.
That set up trust, and every one of the properties is the property address trust.
Trust.
And then,
right.
Yeah,
right.
So I mean, it's not uncommon.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that is a clever trick, though, to kind of get the, to prevent the do-on-sale scenario.
Yeah, nobody's going to look further
yeah,
than that.
Yeah, it's like, that's a really common one, to put
right.
make an address. I do it on most of them with the mortgagee's name.
Which is cool, too.
LLC, John W. Smith, LLC.
LLC. So you're just the registered agent on the LLC.
That's right.
And then
and
the LLC's name is dirt.
I'm the
How creative
operator.
Is that, though? I love
That's
it.
It's pretty fun.
It's
like
great.
That.
Yeah.
The number one.
Do they know that, or does it not even matter?
I do. They have to.
Do
I
you
tell
them
right up front. I'm going to create an LLC. It's going to look eerily similar
I love
to your
it.
Name.
Yeah.
And I haven't had a problem with it.
Not a problem.
Not one problem.
I like that better.
But
than
you
the
know what?
Address,
the transparency, I think, is the biggest thing. Telling them, hey, I'm going to create this
Absolutely.
Entity. I'm either going to name it the address. I'm going to name it the name of who's on the mortgage. It's going to either have LLC or trust behind it, and let them know that versus just doing that. And then whatever happening later, you miss payments, they get all mad, and then they're like looking into it, and they see that they have some LLC out there with their name on it. Because to them, it could be really confusing. Like, who owns the LLC? Just because it's your name doesn't mean you own it.
Yeah, you definitely got to let them know.
Just
right,
be transparent.
Right.
I tell them, I was like, I'll just say, you know, I just do this because it takes some of the... take some of the light off the fact that you've just moved this over. Just tell them the way it is. You
yeah.
know, just tell them how
I love that. Transparency, but again, it's a creative way to keep the mortgage company from just...
Mm-hmm.
If there's no red flags, it's
right.
basically what you're,
the transfer,
you're preventing...
The transfer smooth.
Yeah,
right.
He said it best, smoke and mirrors sort of thing. Mm-hmm. It's not intentional.
But it's not a bad thing.
But it's not a bad
thing.
A lot of people do it. A lot of people do it. Like, for instance, I have two rental properties up North County.
I do it, and I didn't even do subject two.
Right. No, but I wanted to touch on the number one reason why I do put these in LLCs. If you're ever in a situation where you've got a buyer for this property,
right,
and you know, maybe it's a quick selling, maybe it's a fast sell, or maybe there's a lien or some kind of encumbrance on the title, and you know, but this buyer wants to get it, he can clear it up later. You can just sell the LLC. You can just, literally, it's a private transaction behind the scenes. I'll create a bill of sale, hand it to that buyer. The insurance stays in place. There's no title transfers. There's no nothing. The LLC owns it. It's just who owns the LLC now. And that's not.
Wow.
I have.
That's
I have
cool.
Sold,
that's
I have
really
sold
cool.
some that way. And it works really, really well.
Now, whenever that happens, how do you handle that with the seller? Because you're the one that has the relationship with them. Do you have paperwork that you put in place on day one, day zero, day one, you know, so on to say that this could potentially be sold, or does it just get sold?
They're notified of that. I never put any of that in writing, though,
right?
Because you just never know what's going to happen.
You never know.
I mean, I try not to make definitely trying to make any promises I can't keep.
Right.
I mean,
right.
I don't know that that's...
Of course.
You know, I have no clue what's going to happen to that property.
Right.
The goal is to get it out of the LLC and sell it to somebody.
Right.
I'm just saying if you had to.
Sure, sure. Well, it gives you more options.
Right.
Right.
If you had to. I'm not sure about a trust. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that you can do that with a trust. Mm. I don't know 100%, yeah. But this is a simple private sale. There are no kinds of crazy taxes or, you know,
right.
The person just assumes that LLC.
That's awesome.
It's theirs.
That's awesome. Yeah. So let's talk insurance. Seller has house. You buy house subject to. You close either privately or at a title company. We've kind of come through all that. Mm-hmm. You now have all of their mortgage information. You now have a limited power of attorney. And you now have... I guess you'd have in title, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm trying to think. There was another document in there, wasn't there? Am I missing something?
Well, I've got the
limited power of attorney. Oh, release of information.
So,
okay.
Yeah, the process is
that's what
contract,
I was thinking.
Release of information,
mm-hmm.
then my signing period where
right.
I get everything signed. That's my anything needs to be notarized, I put it all in one package, head up to UPS.
Right.
That's going to include my, I have like a distressed seller acknowledgement type thing that I have them notarize. I do a limited power of attorney.
Mm-hmm.
Tax and escrow refunds. I am not going to be hunting people down, so I have a notarized document where I have any taxes and escrow that they have coming back to them at the end of the year, they become the company's. And then from there, we're on title.
You're on title.
So then we can get to insurance. Insurance, I love to escrow it. I hate paying.
Well, that was going to be my next question.
I hate paying.
Yeah,
a big chunk of
question one would be, how do you handle the insurance part of it? And then number two would be, which falls hand in hand, is if the mortgage isn't escrowed already. You know, most are, I would imagine. But if it's not escrowed for taxes and insurance, then do you have to, is that a different process? You know, so on and so forth.
Well, first, make sure you're buying the right type of insurance. If it's going to be vacant for a while, make sure it's vacant. Make sure it's a vacant policy.
Vacant policy, yep.
Make sure you got a landlord policy if you're going to put people in there.
Mm-hmm.
And insurance is literally a matter of me calling up my broker saying, I just bought this property. I need a vacant policy on such and such address in this LLC, and I need an escrow. And that's it. It's immediately accepted by the
mortgage company.
It is.
No shit.
Yeah. And there seems to be like a...
And if it's not already escrowed, they'll start escrowing it?
Well, you have to switch insurances because you're switching the deed over to your...
New company, or whatever.
So whoever's right. on... That was going to lead into my next statement was there's a misconception, I think, that insurance is complicated because you've got a mortgage here and you've got a different person on title. The fact of the matter is whoever is on title must be on the insurance policy. That if your house burns down and you've got, you know, this person's name, the mortgagee on that insurance policy, they're not gonna pay for that house.
Mm.
It has to be who is on title.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So why would somebody do the whole additional insured?
I guess if you're additional, the only way that I would do additionally insured is if I had a tenant in there. I make my tenants put me down as additionally insured.
Got it.
I've not had a problem. Let's just
right.
say that.
Okay. Good,
I've
good
not,
deal.
I've not put the mortgagee or the you know the seller on my policies.
Mm-hmm.
So if
you buy one and the seller already has an insurance policy, you call your guy and you get a new one, and then you may even have that guy be able to cancel the current one, I would imagine, right?
Right. So you got to understand that the mortgage...
Or girl. Could be a girl.
The mortgage company doesn't care.
That's right.
The mortgage company cares about the asset. They don't care about whose name is on it.
So they want to make sure that their investment
asset,
an asset
right.
is covered.
Right. So it's whoever is on title is is what the insurance has to be placed in.
I figured it'd be a lot harder than, like, so more confusing, but it's pretty simple.
Because you're talking to somebody who's done it, and says, oh, no, you just call them up and they do it. Right. It is. It's not that hard.
It's really not.
Literally, I mean, insurance is like the least of my worries.
Yeah.
The biggest worry I have is, you know, paying with my credit card over the phone. That's the biggest worry. Yeah, that's it.
That's awesome, man. That's awesome. So you just call them up, have them change it over into your name. So would it be Jeff Coffman or would it be 123 ABC Street?
It'd be whatever LLC.
The LLC, because that's who's on title, right. Like you said. Right. Okay, that's the match who's on title.
That's right.
Yep. Okay, and I guess you could do the additionally assured into your name, but it's not really required because you own the LLC.
Right. I think you're.
I'm trying to overcomplicate.
You're overthinking.
Right. Keep it simple. Okay.
As long
cool.
as you're, you know, it's a sole member LLC. So the LLC benefits if something were to happen to that property.
Right. Yeah. Awesome. So assuming that was a great explanation, Jeff. Thank you. So assuming that you take over one of these subject two, mm-hmm. which blows my mind that you don't ever say subject two to them, but that's crazy and awesome.
Yeah. Scares them off.
Right. I guess it does. I guess it does.
Because then they go and they start looking. They go out on the internet and they see subject two, and then, you know, with any business, there's always positives and negatives, but they're always going to focus on the negative. I just don't tell them what it's called.
Right. But it doesn't matter.
If they do find out, it has happened to me, if they do find out, I say, well.
Some people call it that.
Yeah.
I don't.
It's a great option.
Right.
It's something that can definitely help you out.
Right.
And if you're wondering whether or not this is a scam, and probably many people have heard this before, but I'll say go check out line 503 mm-hmm. on a HUD one. Not that we're issued HUD ones anymore.
Sure,
where you get these ALTA statements now.
Mm-hmm.
But go check out line 503, mm-hmm. and that is your official government seal of approval right there. It's actually a legal thing. We're not doing anything illegal here. It's just you've not heard of it
right
this way before.
What is line 503 for all the listeners and viewers?
Line 503 on the HUD is the, it actually says loans taken, or title taken subject to existing financing.
So it says it right there on the statement.
Sure does.
Never noticed that.
I think it's line 201 on the seller side and 503 on the
blow right by it. That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah. So another question, you buy one that's not escrowed.
Mm-hmm.
So does that complicate the deal at all?
Start an escrow.
You just have the mortgage company?
Yep.
Because I guess at this point you have limited power of attorney, so you can act on behalf of them. Mm-hmm. So you just call them up and say, listen, I got insurance in place. I either owe taxes or I just paid them, whatever the case is. I want you to start escrowing.
Your insurance company will just send them a mortgage, what do they call that? It's a, I'm zoning right now. I can't think of the name of it, but it's handled through your insurance company. They'll just say, we want this escrow.
Let's escrow.
Let's escrow. All right.
Escrow,
so in the text message or the email you send to your insurance guy, you just say it in there,
exactly,
and then
handle
it.
It's all one
man,
big
it's so simple.
It's crazy simple.
It's so simple.
So
holy cow.
Is there anything that we haven't asked, or I mean, what aspect of the deal do you think? I mean, you don't think of when you're starting out or just starting.
I would say.
What didn't we talk about? You know,
right.
I mean, I would just say the education of it. I fell into it. I made tons and tons of mistakes with this. I mean,
but that's why you're the expert now, though, man.
Man, I told you, and I talked to you before about this this condo that I have, or had. I finally sold that thing,
mm-hmm.
and it nearly killed me. If it were a normal sale, so just to explain this a little bit with condos and community living areas like that. Read their bylaws.
Right.
I mean,
was it an FHA thing?
It was an FHA thing.
Right.
It was also a rental thing. And I was aware of both of those
right.
when I got into it.
Oh, yeah. I remember telling you that.
And I knew the rental thing. I knew it was going to be a flip.
Right.
I knew I was just going to put it right back out on the market, fix it, put it on the market. But I missed the FHA. Hmm. They will not fund it's a certain percentage. I want to say it's 40% of the units in this
of thing. All the units in the complex
could only be FHA. The
right.
rest of them had to be
and
conventional.
There's a it's going on across the street right now in Brentwood Forest here,
right.
where there's like a waiting list for I want to say it's like 15 or 18 months to even rent it because there's so many rentals there now that the people that are moving in aren't able to get FHA because the rental percentage is high. So yeah, I think it's 40-ish mm-hmm. percent, and it may vary from you know areas and states and whatnot, but.
Right.
So you were close on there, and it affected you.
Oh,
were you limited
huge,
on your buyers?
So you couldn't sell it then. You kind of got stuck.
Right.
Is that the
right?
You could sell it. You just couldn't sell it to a buyer that needed the FHA loan.
To a buyer that could that wanted
to actually
right.
buy it.
Right.
I mean, I had it sat a total length on the total hours on the sitting on the MLS, and that's another thing I'll talk about. Total hours was maybe 26, and I had four different buyers, four different people. One
submitted offers.
First day it sat on for 3 hours, I got an offer. Second day, I think it was like six. Second day was the longest one. After that one couldn't get financed, I put it back on the market, sat on there for 6 hours. The next one was like 3 hours. And finally, I'm kind of fibbing a little bit. The last two contracts that I had on it were from the same buyer.
Sure. And now they were.
But that's like, I mean, come on.
And the reason they couldn't get financed was because they couldn't get the FHA loan.
Because,
right?
No, because the complex would not allow FHA. They were already at their limit. They could only do conventional financing. And this person had.
So you're saying that, so maybe I'm going to be schooled here for a second, which is totally possible because I'm wrong most of the time. So you're saying that there's a limit both on the percentage of rentals.
First of all, rentals allowed in this place.
Okay, so that eliminates that.
Right.
Because what I was just mentioning across the street here.
Was the rental numbers.
Was the percentage of rentals to even allow an FHA loan to be able to come in. So gotcha. That maybe we're talking about two different things.
No, I'm talking about totally different exit strategy.
Right, so what you're saying, though, is you're saying is that there was 40% of the units already had been purchased using the existing FHA loans.
Right.
Holy cow, I never even heard of that. Never knew about that.
And I missed it. I totally missed it.
So they said you can sell it, but not with an FHA buyer. They have to go conventional.
To be totally honest, I had no idea that was even a rule.
Right. Me neither until...
It's not an FHA rule. It's their...
It's their bylaw rule.
The point of the story is that...
Right.
All of... In community living situations...
In condos.
I know.
Yeah. And I'm telling you, in community living situations, I mean, I would take the time to sit down and literally read every line of their bylaws.
Right.
Because you just never know. It was a nightmare.
Well, I mean, you're talking about the difference of what's the FHA 3.5% and the conventional is typically going to be 20. So you're talking about 16.5% difference.
Yeah, it's probably like 90% of buyers.
More.
If not more.
Or more, yeah. Right.
The other thing to look out for, and you guys probably already know this, but like if, you know, as a wholesaler, if you're going to get into a property and it's a divorce situation, and you're going to try and sell that contract to somebody else, if you're going to do subject to, be very, very, very paranoid about divorce situations.
Oh, I remember you telling me about this.
Yeah.
You had to track somebody down one time, and
it was a nightmare.
Tell us, just sum it up real quick if you don't mind. Tell us
the
story.
Sure. A simple thing. Guy called me up one Friday night. I was heading out to dinner, and I put his house under contract that night. Told him exactly what was going to happen. No big deal. He agreed to everything. I think by Sunday we were all signed up, minus the.
So you and him.
Correct.
Right.
He was already divorced, so I'm thinking, awesome.
Yeah.
I'll just go pull title. I'll see what's out there. I did a preliminary title search on it, and I saw the it's a marital waiver. So it's basically a marital waiver's given to divorced couples, even married couples that don't want any part of the
that transaction
property.
For the most part,
right.
Okay.
Well, what we didn't know was that marital waiver was created for a different buyer, not me. It was created for somebody else. My title company did not like it.
They didn't accept it.
And
well, good.
It took months. It took months to get that place sold. And all it
needed was
carpet
and paint. You weren't at Old Republic, were you?
What's that?
Said you weren't over at Old Republic, were you?
I don't know.
to remain nameless.
I can see that title company saying no to that.
That's absolutely who it was with.
Man, there's nothing against that company, but they're very, very conservative.
Yeah.
We have problems over there, and you know, we'll still use them whenever sellers or buyers that are doing deals with us want to use them. You know, we're open. We'll do it. We want to make it easy for people.
So we'll go back to talking about
some companies are harder than others.
In the past, we've talked about selecting title companies, and you want to find an investor-friendly title company. That would be an example of
why
it's not. Their bread and butter is not investors.
Right.
So they
just want to make sure they have all their T's and all their I's dotted and crossed to where they know what they're doing.
Those were super nice people. Don't get me wrong. But I felt like every time I went in there, as I was learning more, I was teaching them, and it's like, I'm paying you for this. When just down the road here, you know, from here, there's fantastic title company. I can't worry about any of it.
Right. You're taking words right out of our mouths.
Right. No, it's a good lesson for other viewers and listeners.
Yeah, we absolutely encourage you to go to a title company that can help you, mm-hmm. not the other way around. They're supposed to be the experts on it.
Right.
So, mm-hmm.
And I'm not trying to bash that particular company.
I'm not even talking about that company anymore. I'm just talking in general.
Yeah, totally.
If you're teaching them something,
right.
you probably want to find a different title company that can figure out what you're doing,
right,
and help you along.
And help you, mm-hmm. yeah. And that's one of the things that we love about the two main companies that we use here in town, mm-hmm. is that they work for us. So if we have a problem, we usually will just email or call them, and then it's kind of like they go to bat to try to get that whatever mm-hmm. the issue is handled. You know, and
again, it's if awesome. I'm paying a title company, exactly, I want them to.
I
work
want them
for
to
me.
Do that yeah. exactly.
Well, I'm going to go back to the beginning just a little bit, because I'll tell you how I disclaimer, I am a part-time real estate investor.
Which is awesome, though.
So I do have a W-2, a W-2 job, mm-hmm. And that's why when I first started looking into this, it was more of it was born out of necessity. You know, I didn't have the cash to mm-hmm. go out and do this. So I guess my point behind that is education on it. And I would not make this your primary method of buying houses. It would just be something.
I look at it as a very advanced strategy of real estate investing. And that's one of the most unique things about when I met Jeff. He's like, I only do subject to deals. And I'm like, that's crazy to me.
Well, see, that's what I think, too. It's very niche. Like, there's probably only a handful of guys in St. Louis that even do or have done subject to deals.
But you know what else is very unique is the way that he markets isn't necessarily competing with the way that we're marketing. Mm-hmm. Not that I look at Jeff as a competitor, but he's marketing to people that fit that profile. Whereas mm-hmm. we're like, we want equity.
Yeah, yeah. The thing
we got to get equity to make money.
The
you know,
thing is, this can it's great because there's it spans any list you want to mail.
Right.
It spans any equity that you have in any amount of equity you have in a property. You can do it. You know, if you can sell yourself and make your seller comfortable, you can do it on just about any deal, you know, and that's what I liked about it. It's so
we should give Jeff the deal that we're working on now.
We should,
and if let him handle it because he's an expert at it, mm-hmm. obviously. And if there's $10,000 that needs to be put on the line for the plumber or for the sewer, we should just put it up, because I know that there's $20,000-$30,000 to be made on the property. It's just
yeah, we'll talk
organizing
after the episode.
Right.
How do you like that? He's making me an offer right on
right, the right. Well, I just know you're the guy that can get the deal done.
Right.
So,
somebody ought to do something with it.
Something with
and
it. Right.
Help the lady.
Well, I'll make it a fair trade. I'll make sure that you know how to do it next time.
Even better. Yeah. Even better. Cool. Let's talk about exits real quick. Mm-hmm. We'll see here. We're at about 51 minutes. We should wrap this up here pretty quickly. But whenever you're going to these subject twos, what is your main exit? Are you looking to fix up and then list? Are you looking to get tenant buyers? Is it deal by deal?
Well, first, this is why I got into, getting to know you is because I would get into properties that I wouldn't necessarily want. So I was strictly looking for carpet and paint properties.
Right.
I would carpet and paint them. And then my main exit strategy was flipping them out on the MLS. But I would do doing this by myself, I would do a flat fee listing. Mm-hmm. So I'm only paying 3%. I pay the full 3%. Some people don't even do that.
Right.
So I'll pay the 3% and the flat listing fee. Mm-hmm. So that was my primary exit strategy. Was mm-hmm. just that was my bread and butter. I would just
so paint
there's,
carpet.
There's no market like the MLS. You're just not going to beat it. So that's mm-hmm. that's what I did. And that's what I still like to do. I like to do quick in and out. And then, trying to network, talk to people who know wholesaling.
Of course.
Because I do come across those other ones.
Right.
So I'm truly like, when somebody tells you, you see the ads, I come across discount properties all the time. And the ones I don't buy, this and that. That truly is me.
Right? It is.
You know, I really don't buy everything that I mm-hmm. that I see. So, but that's my primary exit strategy.
Right. So, but again, there's lots of different ways to do those.
Any way you want, really.
But I guess it creates a bigger win for the seller, though, if you are able to paint carpet, whatever the repairs that are minimal and quick. Mm-hmm. And then you can list it. And even if it takes a couple months, you sell it, you know, you are exiting them from their
yeah.
from their issue, because their level of motivation had to be high enough for them to
right.
agree to the situation, the subject to situation.
And that's another thing that I'll do is I will tell them, you know, I've not had one, other than that condo, I've not had one go over 90 days that so if I'm
Man, that is
if I'm in,
quick.
And if I'm in negotiations with them, I'll say,
yeah,
I'll determine.
Right.
I won't make any guarantees because you just never know.
You never know.
It could be title problems, whatever. Right. I will say, you know, I've not had one of these go over 90 days. If you can save me the money on the closing costs, on closing twice, I'll have it gone in 90 days. And sometimes I'll even pay them out of my proceeds. Like, I'll have nothing in the game until I sell. I don't make them a partner, but I will pay them out of those proceeds a little more.
So what would you... So in that particular example, they would continue to pay any type of fees. It'd all be on you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll say I'm gonna make your payments. I'm gonna get in here and fix this up, and I'm gonna sell it. And you know, if they're flexible, I'll give them a little more on the back end.
Oh, I get it. Okay, that makes sense.
Right.
So you say you guys can walk with, you know, $2,500. However, you're not getting it today. You're getting it when I sell it. It's going to come out of the 15-20K that I intend to make.
Right.
Got it. Yep. Okay. Cool. Yep.
I don't offer them. I offer them a flat fee.
Right.
No percentages. No partnerships. Nothing like that. Just
right.
A straight flat fee.
I love it. Well, I've learned
awesome.
A ton today.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And hopefully we'll create a partner right now too on a deal that we're working,
mm-hmm.
which will be like pretty that. Awesome.
I got another one for him too. Subject to
you got one behind the curtains back
behind
here.
Behind the curtain guy here.
Okay. Cool. Well, let's do that one
All right,
too.
Guys. Well, Jeff, is there anything else you wanted to add or plug? Or I mean, what are you looking for? How can we help you?
I'm not a coach. I will say that if anybody out there has any questions, you can just ping me on Facebook. You'll see me around Discount Property Investors page. I subscribe to that. A lot of the wholesaling pages I subscribe to. My last name is spelled Coffman.
Mm-hmm.
Just ping me on Facebook if you have any questions. I'm not going to hand out my phone number.
No, we won't suggest that
questions.
Either.
I will answer questions on Facebook or
cool.
you know,
awesome.
Through email or anything
awesome.
Like that.
Cool. So. And if there's any other wholesalers in town or motivated sellers that, you know, could use Jeff's services, connect with Jeff.
Sure.
Absolutely.
This is a really viable alternative to a short sale or definitely a foreclosure.
Right.
And those are two primary areas that I
bankruptcy
that I
too.
Well, yeah, any motivated seller situation, but
right.
particularly when you've got no or negative equity. I mean, this is something you can get into,
right.
and it's just a slam dunk. It's just a
love it.
It's a
That's
great,
great.
Isn't that cool?
That's great.
Well, Jeff, yeah. I want you to give us the closing quote, if you don't mind.
Oh no.
Yes.
I don't have the voice for this.
Oh
this,
yeah.
This requires a big thundering voice. Everyone's heard this quote, maybe not the last part of it. But quote is, a quick nickel beats a slow dime, but not a slow quarter.
Love it.
Think about that.
Think about that.
Jeff, thank you so much for coming in, man.
Yeah.
We appreciate
That's
it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jeff.
Yep.
Appreciate you, man.
All right. Well,
thanks, guys. We'll see you next time.
Thanks for listening to the Discount Property Investor Podcast. If you enjoyed this episode, please like, share, and subscribe to help us reach a wider audience. We would also appreciate it if you left us a review on iTunes or Stitcher. Thanks in advance for your support. And remember, you make your money when you buy and get paid when you sell. Now let's go build some wealth.